Hey, peace and blessings, you all. It's Sean with Wildenfree Tech, also known as Mr. Wildenfree. Today, I'm going to be showing you all the Tech and App Station, which is a template that I just recently released in the Notion Marketplace. This is a single database, which is made to be incredibly feature-rich, yet also very light and modular so that you can integrate it into your existing system however you feel makes the most sense. So let's go ahead and dive into it. Let me show you what I've configured for your convenience. So here we have the Tech and App Station. Again, a single database. You have a description up here at the top to help you get your bearings, along with a couple of links. And you don't have to look at it all the time. You can use the show hide description up here at the top. Now, getting into the database itself, we have plenty of properties. I'm not gonna dive fully into each one because almost all of the properties have property descriptions where you can clearly get a breakdown of what that property is intended for. I'll lightly touch on all of them, but I'll more specifically address key properties that contribute towards the larger impact of this database. So we have our name property, and as you might have noticed, it has the sub-item relations, which is helpful for any platforms or applications that are a part of a suite. You have your status property, which contributes towards the formula automations, which I'll show you all in a bit. Your cost, of course, which also contribute to that. Your pay cycle, which contributes to the formula automations. The amount of seats, so this is indicating how many users you have on the plan. And that will also contribute towards the formula automations that we have set up. And as you'll notice, we have frozen those first four columns for your convenience to make it easier as you're assessing the rest of the metadata for each record. We have the operating system, we have the type, we have a checkbox for you to mark whether it's essential or not to your operations. The set purpose property, which is a simple text property, but I honestly find it to be one of the most essential pieces to this setup because it lets you clearly define your purpose for this specific tool within your operations. It's really important to understand the context for the tool as it pertains to your specific operations. We have the due date, and we have this wonderful button that is powered by the new formula automations, which allows us to push the date to the next pay cycle. So as an example, you'll notice the pay cycle here is yearly. The due date is October 24th, 2024. If I click on this next cycle, it will move that date to 2025 because the pay cycle is yearly. But if it's monthly, you'll notice October 24th, 2024. It is now November 24th because it is contextually aware to the pay cycle along with the due date. So that is your next cycle button, which is powered by the formula automations. As you can see here, this is the code for it. We have the URL. We have a fees column just in case the application or software that you're using has a different payment structure, which is processed by fees. So say for instance, you have Stripe here as part of your tech stack. You can just put the 2.9% here as a reference, though it may or may not directly contribute towards any larger calculations, since that would likely be processed in a different method. Now going over to these financial columns, we have our monthly active, our monthly prospective, our yearly active, yearly prospective, the single payment total realized, and the single payment total prospective. Now, each of these columns are actually just standard number properties. You can type in them whatever numbers you want for maximum flexibility. These numbers, though, are actually populated with the formula automations. So as you can see here, we have various formula automations pre-configured in this setup to address various things. And I'll go through those now. So from the top to the bottom, we have our yearly recurring prospective, the year-to-date total realized, and those properties are down here. So you have your year-to-date total realized next to your plan start date, as well as a checkbox for whether or not the platform has lock-in. But going back to these columns and the formula automations, we have our monthly active calculation, our monthly prospective calculation, our single payment calculation for prospective, and our single pay realized, our yearly recurring calculation, one that automatically adjusts the price to be negative. So if I put in a number here, you'll notice in a moment that it turns into a negative number. We also have the Substack due date sync. And really quickly, what this does is for the due date column, let's say you change the date on the parent item, the child properties will also inherit that due date. Really easy, really helpful for applications in a suite. You also have the plan start equals the due date when the due date is empty. So say for instance, you add something to your tech stack here and you change the plan start date because, hey, I'm starting this today. Then if the due date is empty, it would populate with that date that you started the plan. However, if your due date already has a date, it won't change, which is good. This just defaults the cost to zero when a page is added, just so that there is a number value there represented. And by default, it's always going to add the number of seats as one. Now, out of all of these automations, if you find that there are some that don't suit you, if you're on a free plan, you should be able to at least toggle them off or delete them. If you're on a paid plan, you can just go in and edit these to match your particular needs. And so let me give you a very clear example of these calculating formula properties. As you'll notice, I can change this to any number I want. It's very flexible in the event that I just want to hard code some of these numbers because I know what they are. It gives you that flexibility. Now the bias is set to where if you want to hard code any of these properties, you would do so after you have already configured the cost property, because the cost is the trigger for many of those automations. So here, let's actually put it in practice to show you how it calculates across the board. I'll enter the number 55. It'll automatically convert to a negative number and it will start to change these properties. So you'll notice that the monthly active is zero because the status of this item is prospective. The prospective column is actually calculating those values. And so you'll notice that the monthly prospective cost is about $5 a month, even though it's on a yearly cycle. You'll see paid yearly is 55. And so this just kind of helps give you a general sense of how much money you would be spending monthly, or if it were averaged across 12 months. And if I scroll over, right now we have our plan start date as September 3rd of 2024. And of course, the year-to-date total is zero because this is a prospective listing. It's not confirmed and it's not something that you have actually been paying for. Now, let's say if we were to change this record to in use, if we wait a couple of seconds, we'll notice the properties will recalculate and then add the values accordingly. Now, the reason you're seeing the value in both the active and the prospective cost is because the prospective cost is going to calculate and adjust for your existing expenses. So at the bottom, we want to have an overall calculation and understanding of how much am I currently paying and how much would I be paying if I were to add all of these additional things on top of my existing expenses. If you want to change that, by all means, you can reconfigure that in the property automation. But that's a bias that I've set here because I just personally thought it made sense. Hopefully it makes sense for you too. Now scrolling back over, we see the plan start and the year to date realized. If I click on this, let's say if I change this to 2015 and hit enter, we'll see that the year-to-date total has now calculated how much I would have spent across the entire duration of me having this subscription. So that's what that year-to-date realized is for. And it's really nice to have that at a glance overview of saying like, oh, this is how much I've actually spent on this piece of software throughout the many months and years that I've been using it. So moving right along, I really want to emphasize this lock-in checkbox because this one for me was really helpful in discerning which platforms actually had some kind of subscription model that locked you into their plan versus those that may have been a bit more flexible, that you might have been able to take a couple of months off, resubscribe, and you're back like you never left. So that's what this property is to indicate for me, and I hope it's helpful for you all as well. Oftentimes, I feel like these applications can be pretty greedy in their subscription clauses. So just be mindful of that and take everything with a grain of salt. If the platform is providing you with a service that is beneficial and helpful for you and you can afford it, then hey, sometimes you gotta take the good with the bad. All right, so scrolling over, we have our main tech and our Substack. So all of the relations that you see here in this database are relations to itself. It's just really helpful to have an understanding of the relationships between the different software and applications that you're using. This is the parent and sub item relationship that we see here with Notion and Notion Calendar. We have the similar apps. So here is a really easy way for you to relate apps that are similar to one another. We have relevant apps, which may or may not be the same as similar, right? So Logic Pro 10 is relevant to DistroKid because Logic is my DAW of choice, or digital audio workstation, and DistroKid is how I distribute the music that I've created with Logic. So creating those kind of relevant relationships is helpful. You have your company email, you have your offer or description of the platform, you have a checkbox to indicate whether you have a profile on the account, you have a username reference, a user email reference, an indication for what authentication method you used to log into the platform. And this is helpful just in case you forget. You have a files and media property where you can add additional links or other reference documents. And you have a button in this last review date property. It just makes it easy for you to say, okay, cool. Yeah, I went in and I reviewed this particular item, and it just logs the date for that. And that's helpful because this can actually be different than the last edited date. You may have edited the property, but not necessarily reviewed your finances or the use of the platform in relation to your current operations. So the last reviewed property gives you a clear indication of when you have actually thoroughly reviewed that particular platform in your tech stack. Now at the top, you'll see a bunch of different views, and the reasons why I pre-configured these is because it just makes it easier for you as you're adding this to the rest of your system. It'll make it a lot easier for you to add them when you are, say, adding a linked view of this tech and app station into any other dashboard. So you'll have all of these options already pre-configured for you. Now, most of them are the same table layout because it's just easier to see all of the information at a glance, but the date added does have a gallery view, which just kind of has these nice cards for you to see. You have one grouped by cycle, the ones currently in use, any that have the type of marketplace or social media, content, distribution, Web3, DAWs as in digital audio workstations, which platforms you have indicated that have lock-in, and this has a more focused view of the table, referencing the actual lock-in column, the cost, the pay cycle, the link, and its set purpose within your organization, and of course, the status. And then you also have one for affiliates. Which ones have affiliate links? And if you would like to support this channel, please feel free to use any of these URLs that are here for these records. All right, now let's actually dive into one of these pages so you can see how I took advantage of the new layout builder. So I'll open this up. It's currently in side peek mode. If that works for you, awesome. If not, feel free to adjust that in your layout settings. You can change this to open in center peek or full page, whatever your choice is. Now, side peek works pretty great for me. As you can see, we've limited the initial view to just a couple. We have the status, the due date, and the next cycle. And then right below that, we have the URL, and below that, the set purpose for the platform. Now we can populate the page with content as we so choose. And for our details, when we bring that over, we have the big number up top for the cost. We have our last review date and the review button, and then very neatly organized sections for the information, your account details, your finances, your related apps, and system related properties. And so that's effectively it. This is the tech and app station. It is now available on the Notion Marketplace. I would love and appreciate you leaving a review. It'll mean a lot for me, and it'll definitely help others who are passing through to understand the value that you've been able to get from utilizing this template. And so that's it. That's the tech and app station. I really dove into this on the fly today. As you can tell, I have a little bit of a different setup. Still using Screen Studio, and I'm largely going to be processing all of this directly through that platform just to reduce the amount of friction it takes for me to release this kind of content. So let me know if this format works well for you, because I don't have that full screen view of my talking head. But you know, the real value is here on the screen. So hopefully this has been a meaningful watch for you. And if you haven't yet checked out the Tech and App Station, would greatly appreciate you doing so. And for the last word before I get out of here, I happen to be the current steward and admin moderator of the Notion subreddit. So if you're a great energy and you want to join the broader community at large talking about Notion, please hop into the subreddit. We have a bi-weekly or fortnightly post for product feedback, which I will be doing my own due diligence to submit to the Notion team so that they have a better understanding of what the community voice is around their product. And so that's it. I said that was the last thing I was gonna say, but I also wanna say, y'all, I finally made it to be a Notion certified ambassador. So I'm really excited about that. Got my official badge on Credly, and cool things going on from here. So if you're interested in consultations or seeing how I might be able to help your organization or your operations as a creative entrepreneur or creative agency, whatever it is, let's talk. I'll be sure to provide a link down below if and when it's ready, and I'll give a greater forecast on what my availability looks like once the dust settles. It's still new. I'm still riding on that high. There's a good deal of reframing I'd like to do now that that has become official, but all good things in due time, and I'll be sure to keep y'all posted. Well, that's it for now. Till next time, peace.